Welcome to Key Insights in Lymphoma Myeloma 2017. I'm Dr. Morton Coleman, Chairman of the International Conference. I am pleased to have with me here on day two Dr. Richard Furman, who is co-chair in the Chronic Lymphatic Leukemia section. Dr. Furman, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
This was an exciting day today at the conference. And we heard a lot of very interesting things, in particular about the important role that signaling inhibitors are now taking place in chronic lymphatic leukemia. Do you think, in light of all the data that was presented here today, that there's any role for chemotherapy in CLL?
Well, I'm really biased, and my answer is no, I don't think there's a role for chemotherapy. But I do appreciate that many physicians disagree with that. And many physicians do actually believe that there is an important role for chemotherapy in a subset of patients. One of the things that's interesting is there are those patients who prognostically we consider to be good. You know, the mutated immunoglobulin patients who can enjoy very, very long remissions with FCR chemotherapy, approximately 70% being free from progression at 10 years, which as a good prognostic group is interesting because while these patients will also do well and probably even better with a B-cell receptor inhibitor, it's sort of the idea about them being chronically on a drug with its potential adverse events and the idea or the need to be taking a pill a day that they're also being saddled with besides just getting something where they're getting 6 months of treatment then they're done. Now, I'm a big believer that we certainly underestimate the toxicities long term of chemotherapy, and while you know 6 months and being done might be very nice for the 70% of patients who are free of progression at 10 years, we certainly can't choose which group the patients are going to fall into, and so there's certainly 30% who aren't. And there's certainly a concern that I have that long term these patients who may be okay at 10 years, but the question is with the stem cell depletion that we see with fludarabine and cyclophosphamide chemotherapy, whether or not at 20 years, which for a 50-year-old is certainly part of the goal, you know, they're going to have sufficient hematopoiesis to actually not develop MDS and AML. So I think right now, you know, people are really focused on, you know, what we know, but I think what we really have to think about is what we will know far into the future. And I think right now that the B-cell receptor inhibitors really do have an advantage. And I think that advantage will only increase over time.
Do you have any idea what the incidence of MDS and acute leukemia would be in that favorable group of patients whom some physicians would like to just simply give chemotherapy to? Do you have any idea what the long-term risk is to those patients?
So we do have data from both the from an ECOG study as well as from Mitch Smith, who also looked at the data. And I think that those data show an approximate rate of about 7 to 8% at 7 years. Now, of course, 7 years is very short follow-up. The idea, of course, was that you know, patients back in the day who were getting treated with FCR chemotherapy typically had a 7 to 9 year survival, and so it really wasn't as important an issue. But now that we have patients whose survival can theoretically continue, it becomes much more important. So we're going to need to generate those data. The MD Anderson data is probably the longest follow-up we have since they are the ones that have the 10-year experience with FCR chemotherapy. The problem is a lot of those patients were treated and then went back home. And so we don't have a lot of follow-up data as to the rate of MDS and AML. But they did report a significant rate of almost 20% of secondary hematopoietic cancers. And I think that that rate is very, very important to keep in mind because I have to assume that a lot of those are going to be MDS, AML, and the rest will probably be Richter's transformations.
Well, the data with the ibrutinib was certainly very, very exciting. Can you tell us a little bit about how well patients who have never seen any treatment fare when they once they're given the ibrutinib, that is the untreated patients?
So it's really interesting. There's definitely a difference in efficacy when you look at patients younger than 65 and over 65, as well as treatment naive versus relapse refractory patients. And we know that the, you know, ibrutinib progression-free survival is far longer for those patients who receive it earlier in their course of therapy. So it really, you know, raises the point that it's important that you do put your best foot forward first. and that the, you know, the use of ibrutinib should be earlier on. And I think a lot of this relates to the idea that if you're going to develop those mutations that may lead to ibrutinib resistance, the sure way to do that is to actually use chemotherapy to induce these mutations, or the chemotherapy to select for a 17p deletion, which does sort of enable that mutator phenotype. So I do believe that chemotherapy first is problematic in that regard. But we saw data today that if you're 13q deleted over the age of 65 and do not have a complex karyotype, you have only 1.9% chance of progressing on ibrutinib at 5 years. So that really, you know, is going to sort of be a number that can't be beat.
Those are extraordinary numbers, to say the least. What about the problem with toxicity? How many patients in this untreated group who seem to do extraordinarily well develop no resistance to ibrutinib? What percentage have to come off for toxicity?
So we do see a lot of patients coming off for toxicities, and we looked, most of the speakers did show the same curves, which actually relates to the discontinuation of ibrutinib, showing basically three groups. An early group that included patients who were coming off for adverse events, a group that were those patients coming off for a Richter's transformation, and those patients that were developing CLL progression. And of course, the adverse event curve was the first one to rise and actually is the highest curve, rising to a level of about 25% to 30%. The Richter's curve comes up and sort of peaks at a rate of about 10% and plateaus at year two. And then the CLL progression due to resistance actually starts to rise at year two and is currently, you know, at about 25%. The question, of course, is how high will that eventually go? One of the things that I think that speaks to is the fact that the Richter's transformation is probably something about the biology inherent in the cell and not something that, you know, we're going to intervene with by doing something differently unless we do it much earlier.
Well, some of these numbers that you're quoting, let's say, for instance, with Richter's, how applicable is that to the untreated patient who is out at 5 years with no evidence of resistant disease or toxicity?
So I think we're actually learning that, you know, the biology of the cell is what's really determining the Richter's risk. And I believe that certain stereotyped V genes, 4-39 in particular, NOTCH1 mutations, and this includes a 3' untranslated NOTCH mutation, as well as 17P, all really dramatically increase the risk of a Richter's transformation. So,
regardless of whether they had been previously treated or not treated.
But the thing about the NOTCH1 and the certain stereotyped V genes is those are present from day one. And that really is something that is the biology of the cell itself. And so these are patients who are going to progress early. And in essence, I think that the, you know, what we're finding is that if you have these, you know, there's a 40% chance of you progressing by year five. And so a lot of these people are transforming before they get treatment. And it's sort of an idea that we need to come up with a different strategy for them.
So how would you approach your untreated patient who has a notch one, but who's clearly in need of treatment? How would you approach this patient as of today?
Well, I think right now, I would probably prefer to give that patient something that's going to be more rapidly depleting the clone, with an eye towards the fact that if the patient hasn't already developed a transformed cell, that rapidly depleting the clone may help prevent that from happening. But what I think is really going to be most important when I envision in the future is that one day, since these patients are notch one mutated when they're diagnosed, why wait? We know that these NOTCH1 mutated patients have a 40% chance of transforming at 5 years. So now that we have treatments that are far less toxic, just start them on treatments very early on with the hope of diminishing that Richter's transformation.
So how would you start treatment? First with ibrutinib and maybe come in with venetoclax? How would you sequence your treatment?
So right now, I would actually favor venetoclax up front in a patient who has a risk of Richter's. I wonder if the slow time to deep response that we see with ibrutinib might actually enable those mutations to cause a transformation while you're watching the patient respond. I don't know if that's true or not, and that's data that we'll hopefully one day have. I mean, the possibility is that the ibrutinib, by just shutting down cell proliferation, will prevent the transformation risk, but we just don't have those data yet. Ultimately, I do like the combination of ibrutinib and venetoclax because that will actually address a lot of the issues. It will, one, take care of those patients who've developed, you know, mutations that might lead to progression on ibrutinib, as well as more rapidly depleting the clones, and address both issues. I think what's going to one day sort of be the ideal situation would be in a group of patients who we know are going to have a risk of progressing, if we treat them early and treat them with ibrutinib and venetoclax, that we can really, you know, prevent those few bad outcomes from really actually happening.
Are you concerned about increasing the incidence of toxicity or adverse events in patients by combining the two drugs? Would it be better to do it sequentially, or do you think combining them is the way to go?
Well, I think there's a lot of synergy to be gained from the combination. I mean, we certainly know that adherence to the stroma really plays an important role in sort of enabling resistance. And so a cell that's able to resist venetoclax by itself might not be able to resist venetoclax and ibrutinib together because it's losing those adhesions, those connections that cause it to be adherent to the microenvironment. And I think that we have good in vitro data supporting the synergy. So I always think using them together is beneficial. Now, I do believe we're going to be seeing more neutropenia and thrombocytopenia in these patients who are receiving the combination therapy. Fortunately, we are able to use growth factors in patients on combination therapy. So it's, you know, because it's not chemotherapy, there's not a contraindication. And so that might enable us to continue. We also don't know if the neutropenia is really associated with a poor outcome. So this isn't chemotherapy-induced neutropenia. And so the risk of febrile neutropenia and frank infections may not be increased with this neutropenia. Now, the thrombocytopenia, fortunately, is also not deep enough that patients run into trouble. The question, of course, is if the thrombocytopenia combined with some of the antiplatelet effects of ibrutinib might lead to trouble. And so those are the data that we're currently generating, and that will be helpful in that regard. Just to sort of expand a little bit more on your earlier question regarding the toxicities of ibrutinib, we did hear a very interesting presentation today regarding drug-drug interactions. And what I'd like to really emphasize, and what I think should be the take-home message from that, is that, you know, there's a tremendous number of drugs that do interact with these agents. And they don't interact directly, but they interact, of course, via either inhibiting the enzymes that break down ibrutinib and venetoclax, or actually inducing those enzymes. And these are primarily inducers and inhibitors of the CYP3A4 system. And with all the different drugs out there that patients are taking, and I use the word drugs because a lot of these homeopathic and non-traditional medicines that people are taking really are drugs. And people forget that, you know, digitalis was a foxglove plant before it was digitalis. So these are medications, in essence, that do have impacts that can really lead to changes in the levels of these medications and have an impact on adverse events. So one of the things I think that was most important from what we heard today was that, you know, there is a correlation between adverse events and these other medications that people are taking. And so if you were to, in theory, stop taking something that was inhibiting your CYP3A4 enzyme, your ibrutinib level may drop enough that you will have the therapeutic benefit without the toxicity that you might have been having because of an more elevated level of ibrutinib.
Of course, CLL occurs primarily in the elderly, and the elderly usually is on a great deal of medicines, some of which are necessary. What do you do if the patient is on a drug that may interfere with CYP3A, and how would you modify your dose, and what do you do for them?
So it's interesting. I mean, I think fortunately there's a huge therapeutic window, and I think that that's an important thing to keep in mind. So there's a lot of safety margin built in. I do, in patients who I know are going to be on a drug that raises ibrutinib's concentration, do sometimes dose reduce to 2 pills. I think that, you know, the important consideration is I always try to maintain, I will absolutely always maintain a dose that's greater than 2.5 milligrams per kilogram. If I have a patient who has an adverse...
That fully saturates...
That's what's necessary to fully saturate the BTK enzyme. And if I have a patient who is not able to basically tolerate ibrutinib at a dose of that's greater than 2.5 milligrams per kilogram, I actually will discontinue the drug.
Really?
Because I do worry about lack of efficacy at lower doses. Now, with that being said, you know, I do believe that if, you know, we don't know everything, and so I'm always going to use full dose ibrutinib unless I'm confronted with a toxicity. And it's just a matter of, you know, starting at 420 and then dose reducing to a level that's hopefully sufficient to generate a response without having the patient have any adverse event.
Well, there are other new BTK inhibitors coming down the pike, as they say. And I guess the one closest to approval would be acalabrutinib. What is your take on acalabrutinib? Could you tell us what the response rates are? And how about the toxicity profile?
So these new BTK inhibitors, what I call the second generation BTK inhibitors, which include acalabrutinib, GS4059, they all actually, and BGB3111, all work through the same cysteine residue at position 481. And so they all still rely on that covalent modification, but they're more selective. And so they, by avoiding EGFR inhibition, we have less diarrhea, less rash. By avoiding some of the TEC kinase inhibition, we have less bleeding and bruising. So they really do afford an opportunity to have fewer toxicities associated. We don't see any difference in response rates.
So we see, what are those response rates?
The response rates certainly depend a lot upon the patient population being studied. But in a treatment-naive patient population, we are talking about approximately 100% response rates.
That's rather extraordinary. And how long have they been following these treatment-naive patients?
Well, currently they've been followed for about 30 months. And what's really going to be the most important question is whether or not there's a difference in PFS. So all of a sudden, with such high response rates, and I emphasize this in my discussion on prognostic factors, you know, yes, you have different prognostic factors, but more importantly, you have different prognostic factor endpoints. So whereas none of our typical or daily use prognostic markers really predict for response to ibrutinib and the other BTK inhibitors, the most important question is going to be whether or not they predict for progression-free survival. So, you know, those are the data that we're not going to have until we have five-year follow-up on all these agents. But that's going to be the data that's going to be most important.
Now, with all the excitement around BTK inhibitors and, of course, venetoclax, which is anti-BCL2, what do you think the role for PI3 kinases is in this situation, in this particular setting, I should say?
Well, I always think that there will be a role. You know, obviously, no drug is going to work for everyone. And so it's always important to have as many options available to us. I think, you know, BTK inhibition and BCL2 inhibition are definitely proving themselves to be more efficacious than PI3 kinase inhibition. But it's certainly nice to still have that to go to should we need, you know, to use it. Now, one of the areas that I use it most frequently are in those patients who, because of comorbidities, might not be good candidates for ibrutinib or venetoclax as well. So it's not just an issue of patients who progress on one and then the other going on to idelalisib, but it's also about the patients who might not be safe candidates for ibrutinib or venetoclax being able to use idelalisib in that setting.
In what situation would venetoclax not be appropriate, in your opinion?
So I really worry about venetoclax in patients who have high tumor burdens and have actually diminished creatinine clearance. That's really my primary concern. Because of the risk of tumor lysis, it's sort of one of those things that can happen so quickly, we might not be able to intervene and save the patient.
Well, would cytoreduction with either a BTK inhibitor or a PI3 kinase inhibitor initially obviate that concern so that you could then come in with venetoclax a little bit later on?
Absolutely. And I think that, you know, these drugs aren't cleared by the kidneys, so it's really just a matter of the tumor lysis syndrome risk. I'd also like to add that obinutuzumab is an option to cytoreduce the patients as well before they might get venetoclax.
Well, do you think obinutuzumab really carries any advantage over rituximab in terms of its efficacy in light of the fact that we certainly use more protein, if you will, with obinutuzumab as opposed to rituximab?
I do believe obinutuzumab is far more efficacious than rituximab. I mean, the data that we have comparing the two certainly used fixed doses, so 1,000 milligrams per infusion versus 375 per meter squared. But I think what really is, I do think that there is a significant difference, and that be it milligram for milligram or not, you know, we do dose these drugs based upon the way they're studied. And so we're currently dosing obinutuzumab, you know, once a week for 3 weeks and followed by monthly times four. And that really does prove to be far more efficacious than the current dosing for rituximab.
I must say, though, that I always hearken back to Susan O'Brien's reports that the higher you raise the dose of rituximab, the greater the response rate. And I would be very curious to see if on a protein on versus protein basis, whether rituximab would not be as efficacious. But certainly today, obinutuzumab seems to be very impressive.
It does. And I certainly would like to point out that Susan O'Brien's data went all the way up to 2,250 milligrams per meter squared. And, you know, the response rate was only 50%, small number of patients. But even with huge amounts of protein, probably enough to turn, you know, a patient into a glob of protein, they were only getting 50% response rate. So I do think that the obinutuzumab is more efficacious. It's certainly, you know, associated with more infusion toxicities and more neutropenia and thrombocytopenia. But it certainly is, I think, a better antibody.
So let me ask you, what would you recommend to the average doctor working in the clinic who encounters a patient who has not been previously treated, treatment-naive patient with chronic lymphatic leukemia? How would you approach this patient today? You would simply give them ibrutinib, or would you have some follow-through?
So if it's a patient who basically has good risk factors, you know, is not NOTCH1 mutated, doesn't have a stereotyped V gene, doesn't have 17p deletion, ibrutinib is probably all they'll ever need. And ibrutinib is certainly easier to administer without concerns for tumor lysis. And as long as it's tolerated, it's very easy for the patient. So that would be my first choice. But if a patient were to have a NOTCH mutation or a 4-39 V gene use or a 17p deletion, those are patients I would actually offer venetoclax to first. And, you know, the obinutuzumab sort of could enable me to treat them as outpatients if I can get them down to a low disease burden and, you know, basically avoid, you know, mitigate their tumor lysis risk.
Now this patient runs into adverse reaction. What would you do to this patient responding to ibrutinib but just simply can't tolerate it? What would you do then?
So it depends on the adverse event. I mean, I think the arthralgias are ones that I usually try to maintain the dose and use a little bit of steroids to get them through. I think those arthralgias do ameliorate over time. You know, we did see very interesting data from Dr. Mato today showing that arthralgias were probably, in clinical practice, the number one cause of treatment discontinuation, which is certainly very different from what we saw in the clinical trials. So the clinical trials reported rates of only about 3-5%. Dr. Mato showed rates that were approaching 25%. So it really was a very significant difference. And I think that, you know, steroids are the first choice, dose reduction is the second choice, but often they'll still persist.
Right.
And those are patients who I then look to actually use venetoclax in or obinutuzumab, because I certainly don't want the treatment to be, you know, something that's going to make the patients, you know, uncomfortable. With regard to the diarrhea, I think there's a few tricks that are very effective in preventing the diarrhea. So one, diarrhea is dose-related, so dose reductions often improve it. There is also a issue where I think the diarrhea is something that patients ameliorate to over time. So if you can just get them through the first couple of months, the diarrhea will subside on its own. But the most important thing for avoiding the diarrhea is actually to have patients take the dose of ibrutinib at bedtime. If they take it and then don't have anything to eat after taking the ibrutinib, they in essence will have what I believe is the EGFR inhibited in the GI tract when there's no food there, and not have diarrhea. And then by the time they wake up and take breakfast the next morning, the EGFR will have regenerated and they'll be able to tolerate breakfast without any diarrhea.
Just one last question. How do you decide between obinutuzumab and venetoclax in terms of as an alternative? There are some people simply who do have enough adverse reaction to ibrutinib that you simply have to take them off treatment. So where would you go next?
Well, I think
How do you decide whether you want to use venetoclax or obinutuzumab?
So I think, you know, the long-term data for venetoclax looks excellent. And there'll be a large number of patients who will have almost really a home run with venetoclax, really getting to MRD negativity. So I do use venetoclax as my next choice, with an idea that, you know, if you really can get someone into an MRD negativity with venetoclax, that there's a significant chance that they might be able to come off therapy and remain free of disease for a very long time. And we are in the process of generating some of those data, looking at drug discontinuation in the presence of MRD negativity. We saw some data from Peter Hillman today estimating that a 10 to the minus 8 level is what would be required to actually achieve cure with our patients. And that, you know, the time to go from treatment initiation to 10 to the minus 4, which is our MRD threshold, is actually the same amount of time it would take to go from 10 to the minus 4 to 10 to the minus 8. And so doubling that time to MRD negativity could actually get people into deep enough remissions that they could come off therapy. And so for something like ibrutinib, which might take 5-6 years to get to MRD negativity, you would have a very long treatment course. But for something like venetoclax, which happens within 9 to 12 months, you know, ostensibly you can get away with 18 to 24 months of treatment and then discontinue therapy.
Now lastly, for the future, do you foresee triple therapy like we have CHOP for large cell lymphoma? Do you see one day where we would put together a ibrutinib or a BTK inhibitor, a venetoclax, and also add obinutuzumab? Do you think that's a possibility? And would that, you think, enhance your ability to, quotes, shoot for that magical cure that we're all want so desperately?
Well, I think we're already doing it. And I think ibrutinib and venetoclax together may be a home run. And I'm not so sure the obinutuzumab would add much. You know, in the trial using ibrutinib and venetoclax, we're actually using 3 months of ibrutinib first, which is sort of, in essence, debulking the patients,
right,
making them safe for venetoclax, and so all of a sudden you don't need the obinutuzumab. And I do believe the ibrutinib and venetoclax are doing the heavy lifting and really responsible for the majority of the benefit.
So do you think that the two together would be a triple and obinutuzumab would be a home run?
I think the two together may be a home run.
Well,
and that's what we're going to have to wait to see.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Furman. We very much enjoyed hearing your thoughts on today's session. This is Dr. Coleman wishing you a good day from Lymphoma Myeloma 2017, an international conference here in New York City.